Welcome to the Sean Geek and Fast Fret podcast. Done.
Well done. Okay, we're going to use that. I was looking at that Zoom recorder thing, you that field recorder. That's really, because I've got a few things I want to try out with the Petty podcast, and some of it will be location because it'll be just too difficult to do it.
Yep.
Here. So I've been looking at options for that. So I'll dig around with that.
This one's okay because you can use it as your interface as well. So you can use it in the studio just to record.
Right.
Well, so it's, I wanted something that was a bit more multi, could do a little bit of everything. So
yeah.
The only thing with this version of the Zoom versus Todd's version of the Zoom, Todd has like actual microphones mounted on it.
Yeah.
So this one, you have to provide your own, but
yeah,
I mean, you could have lapel mics and kind of make it work that way too. So
yeah.
The Zoom H1 was the very first one I bought, and it's like this big, like it's not very, but it's got XY microphones on it. Sounds great. And if you turn it sensitive or really, you know, high up.
Yeah.
I was watching little videos and stuff, and someone actually had it on an ant hill, and you could hear the ants.
Really?
Holy shit balls.
Wow. Yeah, it was wild. It was like, wow. That picks
that
up.
That is crazy, yeah.
Yeah, and the sound quality is really good. You can record it MP3 or wave, I guess. But the newer ones now have a higher capacity. I think it was just version one is one I had, so it wasn't, didn't hold a whole lot.
Yeah.
Hello. Oh, there's the dog. Hey, doggy. Come here.
I can't remember which podcast I was into they were talking about, though. It's like, storage has gotten a lot cheaper now, so you can get much higher storage, but then the bitrate just keeps going up. So you just keep filling it back anyways.
Yeah. Well, I mean, how high of a bitrate do you need, really?
Exactly. It's the same with TVs, man. Like, it's like the human eye can't perceive anything over 1080 anyway, so why do you keep... You can't tell the difference. Unless you're getting, like, a huge, huge screen, you don't need 4K. It's crazy.
I think it's more the refresh rate. That's more important. It's like, especially if you watch YouTube videos, if you watch it in 60 frames per second versus 30, it's like smooth as glass. Like you don't, you know.
But it's a bit freaky sometimes too. Hey, like I remember like the first time you see those, that high HD thing, it's like, oh, that's a bit too real for TV. I don't know why or not, you know? Yeah.
For sound level, how loud are my kids in the background?
Can't hear them at all.
Don't hear them.
Awesome. Yes.
Zoom does a good job of that, man, filtering out. Like, I've had that conversation with a few people. It's the tech, the AI tech for doing that kind of stuff these days is just bananas, you know?
Okay, Luna. I have my breakfast is on the table, so
that's... Oh, yeah.
But we get her on camera. So not to break the jovial mood that we have, but this is going to be Luna's last weekend.
Oh, no.
Yeah, we're putting her down on Thursday. Her Cushing's is caught up with her, so I guess by the
time... Oh, man, I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah, she's the original mascot of the show. Yeah.
How old is she?
She's 11.
Yeah.
But yeah, all her health stuff is caught up with her, and she's starting to get to the point where she's not feeling good. She can't get comfortable.
Yeah.
So there's a nice last smile there for, because Todd wants to see her, I know.
Yeah.
Luna's actually, she's proposed to Todd a bunch of times for married. And, she doesn't care that, you know, Donda's in the picture. She's going to weasel her way in.
She gets on my lap and she gives Donda the stink eye.
Yeah. It's awesome.
Mine.
My Todd. All right.
Yeah, small dogs do side eye very, very well, I've noticed. Better than big dogs, right? They're just like, it's more malevolent or something.
Malevolent. That is exactly it. All right. Well, we're letting her kind of have anything she wants lately.
Yeah.
Food wise. So I am going to, I guess, give her some of my breakfast sandwich, I guess. She's not here for me. All right. Okay. All right.
Is that a Tim's breakfast sandwich too?
It's McDonald's.
Oh, okay.
We don't like the Tim's coffee.
Yeah.
As much. But McDonald's coffee is Tim's coffee now.
Oh, it's the same.
Well, it used to be.
Well, yeah, when Tim's got bought out by that American corporation, they changed the recipe, and then their old recipe was just there. So McDonald's, they just bought it.
Oh, I thought it was the beans that they were getting.
Oh, the beans are, well, yeah, whatever. I don't,
yeah.
Yeah.
The ones that Tim's have now, McDonald's has taken over.
Are you happy?
That's why Tim's tastes different now.
I've been like, it's either 15 or 16 years I've been caffeine free. I mean, I pop every now and again, but yeah, wow. I quit. A man like wow. that. You know, the whole thing, I mean, addiction might be a bit of a strong word, but you do realize when you come off it that it is a dependency. Your body really gets used to needing caffeine, because that week coming off it, man, was hell on earth. Like, headaches, the shakes, feeling nauseous, but I was drinking like way too much as well. But it's just like, holy shit, yeah, I'm glad I got off this, because my body clearly was, this is not a good thing.
Nope. So what type of, so now when you wake up in the morning, are you kind of lethargic still, or are you energetic, or?
Your body switches back, I think. Like, I drink a lot of water, and so as long as I give myself enough lead time, like, I don't usually take call, I don't take work calls before sort of 9 o'clock, because I want to give myself time to wind into the day. Right. But no, I think your body just sort of finds its baseline again, I think. Mine did, I think, anyway, so, yeah.
Yeah, I would agree. I was coffee-free until I met my wife, and then I was pretty much told that
not optional.
You're marrying a Portuguese. You want to marry my daughter, my Portuguese daughter, and you don't drink coffee? No. You don't drink wine? No.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, we better tune you up. So I had my first espresso. And when I went to Portugal the first time, every single coffee shop, give them an espresso. Needs to be a man.
Yeah, so. I'm on my fifth one. Yeah. Drinking it.
Yeah. I'm just gonna go for a quick run.
I was in great shape on that first trip. Before we went, I even, like, Sylvia's like, you got to pretend before you go, because I wouldn't say I'm a ginger, but I'm a freckly
right,
and and I pre-planned or pre-gamed, like, for tanning and all that, and went out there, and I looked, you know, I actually looked good for the first time in my life. And then I came back, and I was like, I put on 12 pounds in those 3 weeks I was there.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you look totally different, tanned, and heavier.
And then all of a sudden, for some reason, the other thing that happened, because it's a Portuguese thing, I couldn't seem to button my shirts past my belly button. Like, I couldn't go any buttons. So I had the shirt open, just like all the Portuguese men, and I'm sweating with them in you know, the shirt.
You're just like one of the gang now. Oh, you just fit right in.
And I had a tan, so I was like, I didn't look like, you know. Yeah.
That's funny.
So I'm officially, according to Sylvie's dad, I'm now 51% Portuguese. I actually crossed that mark there, so.
So you gotta go get a European passport. You know, get on that.
Oh, I am actually. That's why when we're going, I'm gonna set up my own bank account out there, and I'm gonna open up like a small investment, because you invest in the country, and your wife's already has dual. Then, you know, I'm in line to.
Oh really?
Oh yeah.
Oh
yeah.
Oh, that's kind of cool.
Yep. And then we're looking at internet while we're out there, so I can because they never sold their home.
Right.
When they got married, Sylvie's parents got married, they never, like, the house that he built with his own hands, because of course he did, because he does, that's what he does. They never sold the house, and it's beautiful, and it's all concrete. Like, even the 2x4s are all concrete 2x4s and stuff like that. Like, that's how they build there.
Wow.
So it's a beautiful house. And so it's like, I want to set up so I could work out there. So maybe in the summers I could work remotely from out there. Like,
wow.
So that's kind of what we're doing. We're gonna suss that stuff out. So for the people at work that are listening to the show today, like, what the fuck is he doing?
I'm still working. I'm just over there. Working,
yeah. I'd start it.
We all work remotely anyway now, right? So it doesn't matter where you are.
Exactly. I'll start at 2 PM, work till 10, you know, and then still have the weekends and still have the mornings, right? Which is too hot in the afternoon anyway out there. So
yeah. Do they siesta the same as the Spanish? Or
oh yes, they do. Yeah.
Yep.
Yep. Yeah, definitely.
So 2 to 10. What time is it in Portugal? Like, what's the time difference?
It's 6 hours from now. So I don't even know what time it is.
Six hours.
Yeah.
God. Yeah, the guys are calling you from work. What are you doing sleeping? 3 a.m.
Yeah, but 2 to 10 is not bad because it is really hot, like especially in August. Yeah. The last time we went, it was like the average daily temperature is about 45.
Oh dear God.
Yeah. And it was, and at night it would cool down to about like 22, 24 degrees.
Wow.
45. Oh yeah. My, I would just die.
Yeah, it was.
People ask Canadians how do you deal with the cold. Well, I'd much rather have, honestly, would much rather have -40 than +40. I don't know how I'd deal with that.
And the other thing is, I didn't know this was going to be a all Portugal episode, but that's okay. no air conditioning.
Yeah,
because only the rich people have air conditioning. That's kind of a thing there, and no one has screens on their windows. So at night, when the temperature does drop, and you might get a nice breeze. Well, you open the windows and all the bugs come in.
Yeah.
Some of them have like the fish nets or whatever they're called, the screens on their beds and stuff. Because all the bugs come in at night and
nice
windows are open.
They come to warm up.
Yeah. So, careful there. Sorry. She's pulling the cords out.
Does the concrete structure keep the coolness in?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, big time. It has a whole different thing. Like even the floors, like you're walking on the floors and it's all concrete floors, right? It's not hardwood or anything like that. No, it's cool. Like it's cool to touch that. Your feet actually get cold if you're barefoot, which you are most of the time. But it's nice. Like their layout's good. Like you go in the backyard, you go pick a peach from the tree and have your breakfast, and they grow their own grapes and stuff. So they make their own wine. And but I mean, he bought that, like, that would be like 50 years ago. And he bought it for nothing because real estate there is, at the time at least, was way cheaper than here. And he bought a tract of land and he just built. Took him a while to build it, and he built it. And then, you know, there just wasn't a lot of work out there. So he just moved here and he was working right away. Yeah, he did good for himself.
I'm always super intimidated by those kinds of guys who like can build a house.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't have any of those skills. Like if the bomb goes up and we have to reset back to camp, it's going to be at least like 1,000 years before anyone needs a database again. Well, like, I don't know what I'm going to do. Like,
You know what you're going to do is you're going to learn Portuguese and you're going to go seek out another survivor that's Portuguese. And then they will look after you.
Okay.
Yeah. And they'll make their own moonshine, which they call aquadent.
That's okay.
For moonshine, they'll make you some aquadent because it'll warm you up in the cold nights and the apocalypse. And
we'll follow Sean to Portugal.
There we go.
And what the one thing the Portuguese men, what they do, and I'm trying not to generalize too much, but what they do is they make this aquadent, and it's like it's a clear liquid. It's a little syrupy, and it's just pure hooch. And what they'll do is they always try to hide it from the women, right? So they put it in like a 7-Up bottle or a Sprite bottle or whatever, and it's clear. So it's like, no, it's just a 7-Up. But there was one time, I think it was Sylvie's sister. She was hot, and she's like, oh God, there's some 7-Up. She grabbed it, started drinking.
Oh no.
She was a kid. Yeah. Let's just say Sylvie's dad getting a lot of trouble over that one.
Wow.
Yeah. But it's pure, like they put
just
it
ethanol.
Yeah. And they put it in their espresso. So they'll have like, you know, a little mini cup of espresso, and they'll just put a little shot in there. Like,
oh my God, have it
their espresso.
This was before Red Bull and vodka.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's that? The Irish do a similar thing, right? With poutine. So it's sort of potato whiskey.
Oh,
or whatever.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And it sounds like the same kind of deal where, you know, I remember going to the first time I was in Northern Ireland. You go to the bar with all the RUC guys, all the cops, and they say, hey, get some poutine. Well, this thing, like, it'll take the enamel off your teeth. It's just so strong that if you leave the cap off, the whole thing will evaporate within like 2 or 3 days.
Wow.
It's just, and you're putting that in your stomach. Oh my God. And it's awful as well, by the way.
Oh yeah.
Absolutely undrinkable.
It's just get you drunk.
Yeah.
So yeah. So we're going this summer. So very excited.
Nice.
So yeah. You're still
resting. The rest of Europe is, it's all cooler than Britain. That's the first thing. Like, we Brexited and we got away from all the cool places because there's nothing cool in Britain. Like, it's all grey and bloody raining. And we get the opposite thing, right? So over there, there's no AC in the building. Same thing. There's no screens on the windows. But because it's all brick, it just retains that once it gets hot, it just retains all the heat. So you can't, you just can't get cool. Like it's just it's like living in a furnace or like a pizza oven or something. It's brutal. Not that it gets that hot that often.
But. Yeah, but yeah, that's on the bucket list. Is our background, part of our background is Irish.
Right.
Kind of like to do, I actually like to do all of UK. Actually, maybe that's what Todd and I need to do. We want to go to Scotland, right, Todd? And we're going to go hunt down Rage because we're supposed to record with them today. From Scotland, like they're gonna call in, and they're not good on the social media, so haven't responded. Like we said, yeah, we'll do it. That's what they said, and then it's like, oh, I guess I don't know.
So to keep contact with them,
yeah, but they're busy. They actually shut down the podcast. Like their podcast is my favorite podcast.
Yeah,
same. I think you were talking about on the last episode, the one before you were talking about
multiple times.
Yeah,
it's just a Scottish version of Sean Geek Fast Fret. That's literally all it is. And we've ripped them off. We purposely stole some of their topics, and then I'd send them a message later. We stole your topic this week. It was awesome. Yeah,
I find that though in the indie podcasting thing, we're all doing that, right? Though we're all sort of it's like the blues. We're just borrowing. It's homage, and we're just making sure that the thing carries on. And
yeah, I mean, look at Corey with his show, but he just said, by the way, we stole everything from Pot of Thunder.
Yeah, no, but I think he, I don't know, I'm not that, hopefully none of the Pot of Thunder guys, but I think he improved it a little bit. I think there's just there's a couple of format points that make it even more interesting, Now, I stole his format lock, stock, and completely just didn't. Yes. I was like, yeah, that works. Let's do that with Queen.
We thought, I don't know if you heard the story. Todd and I came up with the idea of doing a track an episode for Van Halen some time ago. But this came right after. So we had an episode where we're talking movie soundtracks, and Todd's like, oh my God, T2 and Guns N' Roses, the Guns N' Roses tune. And then we would play let's just play a little clip so people understand what song we're talking about. This is before we were punching in audio clips.
Right.
And then we did that. And then there was that, I think, was it AC/DC, Todd, or something? Anyway, it was all big bands. Like, it was like the biggest bands. Like, and it was Warner Brothers and BMG bands, pretty much.
Yeah.
And then we played, and it was like 30 seconds here, 30 seconds there. And at the time, with the podcast host we had, it would auto create an episode on YouTube. So there would be like just a page of the logo and auto uploaded to YouTube. So we posted the episode, and the next day we get 5 cease and desists. Oh, it was Heart. Heart was one. It was Heart, Guns N' Roses, AC/DC.
Yeah.
Berlin?
Berlin. Maybe it was Berlin.
I wonder which song.
Exactly. I remember searching for the perfect words. I was hoping you might change your mind. I remember a soldier sleeping next to me, riding on the metro. And then we got that, but that's because it's on YouTube, and YouTube has this algorithm thing where they catch snippets and then they, give you a cease and desist. And what I didn't realize at the time was, well, that's just how YouTube works. But then I'm like, Pot of Thunder had their show for, at that point, like 7 years or 6 or 7 years at that point. And it's Kiss. And Kiss is, you might not have heard of them, but they're kind of a big popular band. They're doing their 7th End of the World and I'm like, if they didn't get shut down, like what, like I don't get it. So we decided not to do it, and then Corey starts his show, and I'm like, fuck, should have just did this fucking thing.
I went through the same thing though with, like, when I started the Petty podcast, so I looked into
you never play.
I don't play it. And I was
I have a question though.
Yeah, go ahead.
The little musical points in there is that's just you playing, right? I'm assuming.
That's my friend Randy. I can't play guitar. I've got guitars. Okay. I just don't play very well. Okay. No, my mate Randy is who I do the Queen podcast with. He does all the stings for me. So
okay, because those are awesome. I almost like that better in some ways. But anyway, go on.
No, so, I was just saying, like, because I looked at the copyright law and I thought, well, I don't want to get on the wrong side of that. And you sort of, you know, when it's one of your hero bands, you also don't want to sort of be disrespectful to the estate.
Yeah.
So that's why I made that decision. But then I get on and, I'm listening to Corey. I'm like, well, these guys are playing.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, essentially the whole fucking song just.
Oh, yeah.
I don't.
Oh, yeah. There's definitely. Yeah.
Okay.
And the kids can't hear you. So
okay, good. Okay. So I was like, well, they're playing it. So damn, I could have done that. But I actually ended up, it's funny because I got please don't do that from the Petty Estate about merchandise for the podcast. Because the merch is a logo, and I got permission from the guy who painted the artwork to use it for the logo for the podcast. But I had that as that one. But the Petty Estate, someone through the fan club kind of organized manager said, yeah, they'd rather you didn't use Tom's name. Or I was like, well, yeah, no, okay, that's fine. But it's like, holy shit. Like when you're this tiny little indie podcast thing, and then someone from the band says, don't do that. You're like, oh, Jesus Christ. Yeah, that's all right. Okay, no, I won't.
So, can you abbreviate it? Just put like TP?
I sit up to it's 898 now. 898 rock and roll. Because 898 was the we're getting into Tom Petty, which was not the point, but when they released Hard Promises, the record label wanted to apply superstar pricing to it, because obviously they're coming off the back of Damn the Torpedoes. That's a huge album. They know they can cash in on Petty, right? But Tom Petty's like, no, you're not doing that. Like, it's gonna price people out. We're not doing that. So
of course he did the
Yeah, of course. And MCA said, well, you know, we're gonna fight you on this. And he said, okay, well then if you do that, then I'm gonna call the record either 898 or don't buy this record. Like, there's all these things, all these ideas he had to say to get the message across that you shouldn't buy this record. So, and he ended up winning, right? So they kind of backed down. And but of course then after that, a year or two after that, everyone's album price went up, and that's continued to do so ever since. So
wait, so what year would that have been then?
That was 81.
81, okay.
81, yeah.
Oh, wow. And yeah, you really blew, like, after that point, like, he blew up even more. Like,
yeah.
You don't come around here no more. You don't come around here no more. Whatever you're looking for.
I listened to it. Not something I would go buy. Like, it's not the Van Halen to me is I guess Kevin's version of Tom Petty.
Yeah,
that's my niche, I guess you could say. But yeah, Tom Petty's fine. Yeah,
I think your band needs to cover Tom Petty, Todd.
I think actually we do one of their tunes.
That's where I was leading. Like, I'm sure your band plays that Petty song. Let me guess. Not Free Falling. It would have to be a rocker. Todd doesn't remember song titles at all, by the way.
Nope.
It's the song.
You have to sing the whole thing.
It's the one that starts in G. Oh, that one. Yeah.
Oh, that's funny.
Oh, you go. Oh, yeah. I'll say the song and say, oh, that's not Tom Petty.
or when Dome would play, okay, we're going to do Descend or whatever. And it's like, which one's that one? It's the one that goes, that. Oh, that one.
Well, it's the same thing though. I've got a set list and I have to put down what note I'm going to start on or something. Right. Like, just so I know, do I start in at the same time as everyone else, or do I kind of just sit back and wait for, you know, to get cued in type of thing? So, yeah, I'm not good with...
I was gonna, oh man, every time we go see Dome live, like, the bass player always starts the song. I don't know, it must be, that's a super interesting creative choice. No, it's just to make sure that the guitarist knows what song they're doing.
Yeah, well, even
is
even
it this
Oli,
one?
Like, even Oli didn't know the names of any of the songs because he's like, I don't give a shit about the lyrics. Like, all that matters is how awesome I am on drums. Like, that's what his attitude always was, right? But Alex,
drummer, say,
oh yeah, well, Alex. Alex would come up with the riff. He'd come in with the riff, and like, Todd will agree. Like, as a creator of licks and stuff, Alex always came out of completely out of left field.
Wow.
Like,
yeah.
What the, like, that doesn't even make sense. And I remember Todd watching, going, I wouldn't have played it that way. Pretty cool though. But so Alex would come up with the riff, and then he would talk to me, and I would come up with like a vocal first, not even a lyric, but just like the melody. Yeah. And there was always like a really concise, like, okay, the chords you're picking. So this is a rocking song, but there's an underlying undertone of something under there. So, and then I think this is how it worked out. I think we'd have like a song title, and we'd start with a song title only. And then it's like, okay, Sean, go write.
Yeah. So then, you do all the lyrics.
I did all the lyrics. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So then it would, but the lyrics had to capture the mood of the title. Cause we had a whiteboard. I don't know if you remember this, Todd. We'd have a whiteboard on the wall, and we'd have the song title, and then we'd kind of break down what we were doing. And then I would have to try it as we had one song called Pinprick. I'm like, what the fuck am I supposed to do with that? Pinprick. Like, where the hell did that come up with? But Alex says, you just say a name. And like that's what, because that's the feeling he was getting when he came up the list, right? And it's like, oh god damn it. Like
a lot of that was I made notes on the that one that, you know, you don't always get a bass led bridge.
No.
And that really trashy splash cymbal sound. I was like, man, that's pretty freaking cool. I love that.
I love that splash he had. It was just fat. Just
sounds nasty though, right? Yeah. You know, it's got that really dirty kind of,
He hit it hard too, man. Holy crap.
He hit all the drums hard. It's the only drummer I've ever actually had to put earplugs in.
Oh, really?
It was, otherwise you'd be pretty much partially deaf by the time.
Alex and I worked, I think we worked together at that point. Yeah, I think we worked together at that point. So we would get the free, the high-end earplugs, the ones that you could still talk.
Yeah.
We always had earplugs for practice.
The frequency filter things, yeah. Yep. Yeah. I was talking to Randy about that, and he said, when you get to a certain age, like, I will go through the board. Let's all wear headphones. You can play the electronic drums. We don't need to be making too much noise here. This is.
Alex wrote pretty. He had a unique way of writing. See, when we grew up with kitchen parties with cowboy chords, right? So you had three chords per song, and you're playing Johnny Cash and whatnot. And then when you grew up in the '80s, then it's like the '80s metal hair stuff, and then that's the type of style that you kind of is your influence. So when it came to Dome and then playing with Alex, and Alex would come up
with Todd's a guitar player, keeping in mind, like Todd's a guitar player playing bass and sorry, go on.
Yeah. So there was a different element to the way I was playing. Plus I was playing with a pick with Dome. I don't play with a pick anymore, but just, to try and keep up with the sound and the grit and the, I had to and the speed of it. So but the way Alex was writing was very unique. And to try and find something in my style to match up with it, we had so many different influences. That's kind of how it turned out.
Well, and that really comes through on that Kitchen Sink album, right? Like I was going to talk to you about that because you can hear all loads of different influences. When you get the CD through, thinking it's like Folsom Prison Blues. I've just listened to Dome, and I'm going to get this. This is going to be really cool.
Train a coming is rolling round the bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on. But that train keeps rolling on down the San Antone.
Was that you on drums? Was that you on drums, Sean?
On Folsom? I did everything on Folsom.
Because that shuffle's not easy to, man. Like as a drummer, I always appreciate when someone can play that snare shuffle.
He's programmed.
It's programmed. Okay, fair enough.
This was through that drumming program. What was it called?
I have it too because I sometimes I'll use it as just to save the tempo, and then I'll just go record it myself.
So I put that on Reaper. So I'd listen to the song. I'd have it in the back. And I go, okay, well, it's so many parts here, and then it goes into the bridge, and it goes in. So I wrote the whole thing with the drums first.
Yeah.
Then I grabbed the bass, and then I put the bass line over top of it. And then I grabbed my telly, and then I did the telly portion over it. And then I did the singing after at the very right. end. So, yeah, so it was pretty much all homemade except for the drum part. But, yeah.
Yeah, so not bad for first-time vocal, I think.
First time?
Yeah. First time, Todd's first time.
I'm not a singer.
Well, you can feel me, man. It sounds pretty good to me.
Yeah.
Well, thank you.
We played it for mom. I remember you sent it to mom.
Yeah.
Mom's like, oh my God. Your brother can sing too? Well, yeah.
I can't walk and chew gum at the same time, though. That's a problem. Like, even with our band playing bass, yeah. where you don't have to think as much as when you're playing the guitar because you got less, you know, chords and stuff to deal with. So I would be able to sing more if I was, you know, playing the bass, but still I can't do that.
I can't do it either. I can't syncopate it. I can't get my hands on my voice. I can do it on, you know, yeah, I'm a drummer. I can get different parts doing different things, but the voice thing, unless it's a straight four on the floor, I am screwed. I can't do it.
Wait, can you sing and play drums then?
You know what? I can sing along, but I've never tried it like in a pressure situation where I actually have to keep good time. So I don't know.
I couldn't do it, but then there was one band, our old band Classic Embers, right, that Todd and I were in with my dad, with our dad.
Okay.
And I was the singer in that band, and then we had a drummer, Dick, and he was the drummer, but occasionally Dick, well, I gotta go on business or whatever, right? So there was one time, so I'm singing, Todd's guitar, Dad's bass, Bane is rhythm guitar, and we had that other Dave guy on acoustic. Dave,
yeah, I think it was Dave. Yeah.
Yeah, so you know we're practicing, and then Dick can't show up. So then my dad's like, "Oh, Dick's not here to play drums. Sean will play drums." Like, well, who's gonna sing? Well, you're gonna sing. So you know, we'll just move the microphone behind the kit there, and then you'll be fine. Don't worry about it.
Just need the harmonica and the chest expander and the little cymbals between your knees. So, one man band.
So that's how I learned. And then when Classic Embers, we had there was a big. I don't know if I should say this on air, but let's just say that there was a parting of ways with my dad in Classic Embers, and then Todd followed right after because, you know, dad's not there.
Actually, I think I was going first.
Were you going first? Oh, you were going first. Yeah, and then
I had young kids, and it just got to be too much.
Yeah. But I stayed because I was kind of having fun. So then I just became the drummer, and then they brought Roger in to sing, and...
How old were you guys back then? Like, how old would you have been 20s, when you were in that band? 20s. Okay.
Yeah. Right? I think, yeah, it would have been
30s. 20s. Well,
yeah.
I was probably 30s.
Yeah. And then, so I was drumming, and I sang like on lead on a couple of songs or something. Like, we let Roger sing, which was a huge mistake. Like, I'm not saying I'm a great singer by any stretch of the imagination, but Roger was god awful. And I'm sorry, Roger, if you're listening. You're probably not, because I don't think you liked me, but it was bad. So the ones that I got to sing was I used to do Ahead by a Century on the drums and vocal.
Oh wow, okay.
Really hard.
Yeah.
Because the beat on that song, I don't know how familiar you are with that song. It's not normal, traditional. It's that drummer thing. I'm just gonna do something different. Very, very difficult. And then New Orleans is Sinking. I did double duty on that.
Jeez Louise.
Yeah. So, but the funny, I don't know why I'm going into stories about Cloud. Why not? Because that's what we do here. It's Albuquerque time.
See, you know, I knew I should have made a left turn at Albuquerque.
But there was one show. So that they brought a different bass player in. It wasn't my dad, and it was this other guy. I can't remember his name, but holy shit, was this guy good. And by good, I mean he was playing rock songs because it was easy. Like,
you
know, this is a weekend thing for me. He'll come in, and he didn't practice nothing. He just came in, just started playing. He was fine, but his background was all kinds of music. He played everything. This guy was amazing. I wish I could remember his name, but he grew up on funk and jazz and that sort of stuff. And I mean, I did grow up on that stuff, but I like playing that stuff. So
yeah,
we're playing Lying Eyes by the Eagles, right? And it is the longest song in the history of man. It's, when you're playing it on stage, it is the longest song And me and the bass player are looking at each other like, okay, this is a song where we could actually leave the stage and no one would notice the bass player. So we're like, okay, whatever. So we're playing. We're at the 11th verse in the song.
Is this practice or is this?
Oh no, this somewhere? Is live. This is live. Okay. This is in Ontario. We played in Ontario. I can't remember the place.
Anyway, you guys traveled?
No, it was the place we played before. Remember? We played before. They rented a cabin for us for the weekend.
It was at the lake.
At the lake. Okay. Is that Ontario? Eastern Manitoba, somewhere.
It's Manitoba.
Anyway, so we returned the following year to play there, and then it was a shit show. Like when we went and played with Dad and Todd, the first night nobody was there, and the second night, the five people that showed up, I guess they told everyone in town, and the second night, and it was awesome. Like the dance floor, like, we have a couple of videos of it, but it was awesome, and it was like. Everyone's like, holy, you know, they really liked us. They thought we were really good. So when we came back the next year without Todd and Dad, everyone was like, oh my God, they're back. You know, it was like a year later or something. So everyone came out for that opening night and they were like, I thought it was the Classic Embers. Like, this isn't the Classic Embers. Cause it was absolute shit. It was really, really bad. And I remember between sets, I'd go in the crowd going, I don't know who these fucking posers are, but that's not. and it was like, so the bass player and I were like, well, this is embarrassing. And the other guys were just like totally oblivious. Like, oh my God, it's such a good turnout. Yeah. It's a turnout, but everyone's fucking booing. So anyway, so on the 11th verse of Lying Eyes, he was over this way. I'm looking over this way and I'm playing and I'm trying to get his attention, you know, splash. Psh, hey, and he looks at me and I'm like, and he's like, so I break into Cold Sweat by James Brown. And he's right in there. Like it was almost as good as when I play with Todd, right? Where I can change gears and Todd's like, oh, I'm right there. Or Todd changes gears and I'm right there. And we just start doing the cold sweat rhythm section for Lying Eyes.
Brilliant.
Oh, it was awesome. And the crowd stopped finally, like, okay, now we're getting something interesting, right?
Yeah.
Singer turns around and he's going to hate me for saying this out loud, but I don't care. He turns around, but his mic is still like, he literally went like this. So he's still in the mic and he goes, play the fucking song. The whole crowd hears it, and then we played in another bar or two or whatever, and just and then we switched off, and then he was so mad, he gave us so much shit after, because this is a guy who doesn't improvise ever. He doesn't know how to improvise.
Yeah, and that's a totally different skill, right?
Yeah, but it's the thing, you have to be able to read the crowd when you're playing. If the crowd's not into it, don't just keep fucking going, like, do something.
Yeah,
you got to get the crowd, like, you don't just go up. I know we were a cover band, fine, but you don't just go up and just play the song. Well,
just because then you can just stay home and listen to the record. I've never understood that. Just put it on the jukebox at that point, right? But I got to. So first of all, the improvisation thing, my friend Randy is putting his old cover band back together and was auditioning bass players. He said he brought this guy in, super nice guy, good player, but just couldn't draw outside the line, couldn't color outside the lines, right? So when they'd sort of just switch, he'd be what? He'd carry on playing the part that he had rehearsed.
Yeah.
It's like, well, no, you got to be able to listen to what the rest of the band is doing, because that's what live music is, right? Yeah. But I got to tell you, man, way, years and years ago, like probably, I don't know, 1980, 81, my dad was in two bands when I was growing up, two cover bands. And they were a pretty big draw around town. They were a pretty decent cover band. And they used to do Lying Eyes.
Where was this?
This is in Wigan, England. So Northwest England, just between Manchester and Liverpool. Yeah. The hotbed of music. And so they used to do Lying Eyes. Like I said, it's a six and a half, 45, six and a half minutes song. It's a long song.
Wow, so this is good. This is really good. Okay.
But they get this 19-year-old drummer in to replace the drummer because the drummer leaves. Well, this kid's nervous as hell. They got through Line Eyes in 4.5 minutes, and there's a tape of this. It's like double time. It's like a punk rock version. And they're all like, Jesus, we can't keep up with this. Like, after the song, like, dude, you've really got to slow down because we just can't compete with this. But what they used to do, too, is like with the old drummer, my dad said, the thing that they do on stage to keep themselves interested, the two guitarists would just keep turning their amps up slightly, so the drummer had to keep hitting the drums harder. And by the end of the set, like, they're on 11, and he's just wailing on them. It's not funny anymore, guys. Will you stop doing that?
Oh, that's good.
That's a normal thing, I think.
So the Eagles wrote possibly one of the worst songs of all time for other bands to cover.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. I do like little fills and stuff. Like, I got to do something here. This is so fucking boring. It's a good song, but I don't know.
Yeah, if you're playing and someone drops a pick or the singer has to cough or something and then they lose their place,
yeah,
you have to be able to improvise and go, okay, we're just going to run through this again, okay, and then start. But if you're really rigid in how you've practiced, is okay, well, this, there's so many bars, and then there's so many bars, and then and if you're doing it that way, then yeah, then you're totally lost. Then it's like, oh, what note is he playing? Oh, where is he at now? And then the bass player is probably panicking.
I wonder. So I have a question. If there's any drummers listening, and if you're in a cover band and you play Lying Eyes, did any of you have a it's not a digital delay, Todd, what's it called, where you can what Ed Sheeran uses all the time, where you play the lick,
that loop thing,
looper? Yeah. Has any drummer out there ever bought a loop pedal for the drums, played the first verse, and then walked away to go to the washroom? Because you literally could. Like, if you get the first verse and the chorus in, I know Don Henley is an American institution, and he is an amazing drummer.
Yeah.
But I don't think so.
But, I mean, Eagles wrote some, they wrote some pablum, right? I mean,
oh, God, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But it's that, I was talking to a guy, Jeff Slate, on one of the pods, and he was saying, we were talking about, the death of, mainstream rock or whatever, and he said it was Eagles, man. Like, they came in and they literally put that band together to make money. A band that sort of organically came up, right? It was just, well, we need to hit the charts with a certain sound. We need to country's getting a bit rocky now.
Was, originally, I think, the original, when they were more countrified and stuff, and they came off of whoever they were playing for, I can't remember, not Tanya Tucker, it was, anyway, they're it was Fry and Henley that were backing, my God, who the hell it was? And that's how they get their deal, is the Eagles. But
yeah,
back then, they were actually writing some music, but then they're like, okay, let's shift gears and let's commercialize.
Yeah.
Like, go on. I'm sorry, didn't mean to cut in there.
Oh, no, that's exactly where I was going with it.
Yeah.
So, summarize beautifully.
But then they're like,
oh, yeah, man. I mean, as a band, as musicians, they're great.
Oh, yeah. Felder got fucked, though.
Oh, yeah.
We don't like the way you play anymore. We're going to bring in the hotshot guitarist, alcoholic, drug-addled, Bocephus, call him Bocephus, guy in, the crazy fucker.
Yeah.
Bring that guy in. It's like, hey, if we have a Muppet on the stage with us, we can bring in that other additional audience, right? And it was so calculated.
Yeah, you gotta love Joe Walsh, though, right?
Oh, he's amazing.
Do you ever listen to this? So when the Eagles released that huge box set of all the outtakes and all that kind of stuff, there's a brilliant bit in one of the studio sessions where he's basically, I can't remember which song it is, but he's brought this song in and he says, "Hey, I'm gonna play, I've wrote this song, guys, listen to this." And one of them shouts, I think it's Henley, says, "Oh, is it in E?" And he says, "Hey, I made a lot of money in E."
Oh, we used to play Rocky Mountain Way. God, every band.
Great track, man. Yeah. Such a great track. And he was the real deal. James Gang was great. He was the real deal, man. He was a real musician. Oh, yeah, and still, but yeah, just absolutely batshit crazy.
Funk 49.
What's that?
Oh, Funk 49.
Yeah. 49, yeah.
Brilliant.
My favorite track off Hotel California is actually his. And that's just to be contrarian.
Which one?
I can't remember. Pretty Maids All in a Row.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's a Joe Walsh song. And
that's a really good one.
It's weird. It's different. It's experimental. I don't even know. Is there even a chorus in that song? It's just him playing, and it just feels kind of real, I guess. I don't know. It's not, you can tell he didn't write, okay, I'm going to write a hit single. No, he just, here's my song, guys.
Yeah.
It's a laying down with your headphones on type of song. just kind of just immerse yourself.
Well, that's so hard too. Like, I don't, those guys down in Nashville or like the pop hit factories, to sit down, like, have you guys ever sat down and thought, I'm going to write a song today? Because really, usually it's just got to, the idea just comes, right? And then you got to be ready for the idea, and either, you know, you sing it into your phone or you just sit down and actually play something. But I've never, like, anytime I've thought, oh yeah, I've got a bit of free time, I should sit down and try and write something. Nah, not happening.
I did that once.
Did yeah. You?
That was flying.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I said, okay, how do you write a song? Because every structure is different. I mean, a jazz song will write it a certain way. A rock song will be a certain way. So I went, okay, well, what's the meat and potatoes of a song? Okay, well, you got the intro, you get the chorus, you get the break, you know, just how it's all structured. And I went, okay, well, I'll do this part here, and I'll do this part here, and then this part will be here. And then I did it, and it was like, okay, there we go. There was the song.
That's so super cool.
Yeah.
Oh, I've never sat down and done it that way. It's like, oh shit, there's a riff. And like, I'll be right back, and I'm singing the riff in my phone or whatever. Like, but it's weird though. Oh God, the dog just left a really interesting smell. Actually, I'm going to pause for a second. I think she's going to go.
Okay. An interruption in the podcast.
must be the sandwich. Maybe there's eggs in it or something.
Yeah. Yeah, flying's great, man. Because I love Satriani, and that's where I sort of that's what it puts me in mind of that song, because it's got that really nice melodic lead guitar.
Oh,
but the rhythm section is kind of interesting. Where I was just like, you know, all the shredders. I'm not really a metal guy, and I'm not really a shreddy guitar kind of guy. But so I love Steve Vai, and I think he's just one of the coolest, most genuinely brilliant people on the planet, and he's probably a better guitarist than Satriani by this point. But I always like Satriani's ear for melody. Well, because they're just way more melodic, his tunes, right? You could imagine those being melody lines being sung in a lot of his songs. So I just kind of gravitated toward that. So flying always, that's what it reminds me of.
Well, for the love of God, when I listen to that one, that's another one where you can kind of just lay back, put your headphones on, and just get lost on the song.
Yeah,
he did some awesome writing, both of them, both Satch and Vi.
But Surfing with the Alien, man, like that went. That hit. I mean, that was top 10, right? I think in the US,
it went one or two times platinum. So,
for an instrumental, rock guitar album is really unusual.
Yep.
Yeah. I had Satch Boogie on my telephone answering machine.
Oh my!
I played it, and then I had it. You know, those little cassette tapes. Yeah. I played it, and that was kind of the beginning of my answering machine. It would come on, and I'd say, "Hi, I'm not here right now, but."
Did you do the dive bomb? That ridiculous, horrendous dive bomb where he sounds like he's strangling his guitar to death.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah,
unreal.
Oh yeah, Todd
still have it somewhere.
Definitely dive bombed.
Yeah,
I remember like I was like I don't know how old I was. It was grade 9 or grade 10 or whatever. And Todd's band, Todd doesn't even remember what his band was called, but they were called Mitoma. Or
Overload, I think it was.
Yeah. And they were, you know, they just play the school, you know, like whatever. What'd they call it? Not tatatak, what they called it?
it was a French word, but I can't remember.
Yeah. Anyway, it was basically like Soundbox or I can't remember. But anyway, so Todd's band would play, and they never had a singer because there was never a singer. Like, so they're
right.
Okay, what bands have instrumentals? So they play a rush. But anyway, so Todd's behind the curtain before the curtain's going to open. And then Todd's behind there doing horse whinies out of the guitar and elephant sounds. And they're like, what the hell? Everyone's like, what the hell is that? Like, just wait. Like, you know, that's my brother. I remember that. I don't know if you remember
that. That's awesome.
Yep.
Yeah. We were playing, was it Roy Orbison's Pretty Woman? Mm-hmm. And then during the break, I was doing the Eruption.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah.
It fit in. Just the way it kind of, just a part of it, not the whole thing. But those were the good old days.
Is a question for you then, well, both of you, Todd, but Todd is the guitarist. Like, is I'm the One the single best hard rock guitar part that's ever been played by anyone? Big question, I know, but I listened to that isolated guitar track on YouTube at least once a week.
You were mentioning that.
And it blows my mind every single time I listen to it.
I'm the One?
Yeah. Oh, you don't know the song? Of course, you don't know song titles. Yeah,
exactly. Hang on, I'll actually... bring it up here.
Yeah.
It sounds super familiar. And as soon as I hear it, I go, yeah, that's the one.
Yeah.
That's the one? I'm the one.
You can't hum it, right? It's just, but it's got that really specific Eddie Van Halen shuffle to it. And you can tell when you listen to the isolated guitar track that it's one take.
That was so one. I think if it's the same one I'm thinking of, yeah, I tried doing that. I was able to get partway through the song, learning it, and then I just kind of give up on it. But.
It's almost like a solo all the way through because his rhythm part's so interesting. And I always talk about, you know, his timing, his meter was so unbelievable that when he comes out of that solo and hits back into that riff, it's just perfect. Like most guys, you're going to have to get punched in on that because it's ridiculous, but he's so good.
Yeah.
Just a different level, that boy. I mean,
well, he's playing he's playing lead and rhythm. So he's very, like, to transition from one to the other is just seamless.
Yeah. It's crazy.
Yeah.
What a shitty bass player Mike Anthony is, eh?
Oh, dreadful. Alex Van Halen. I mean, the worst rhythm section in rock, right?
He's like, bah, 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 bah. This is so good. Yeah, does not get enough credit.
No.
No, yeah. Not at all.
Yeah. Well, I didn't realize that was a thing until I started listening to the Corey's podcast, that people don't rate Alex Van Halen as a drummer.
No.
Like, oh, I just always thought everyone knew that the guy was a badass. Well, okay.
Hey, if you're a drummer and you've ever tried to play Alex Van Halen, yeah, then you know different. You definitely know different because, yeah, he's next level. Like, I remember, like, when I was playing my own, like, when I started playing drums, and Todd was a virtuoso by that point. And then if Todd was ever kind enough to let me play with him, I'm like, well, what do you want to play? What do you want to play?
Yeah.
He's like, oh, let's, do you want to play Hot for Teacher? Whatever, like, and you know,
you're little Remo kit.
Oh. I think I was deliberately picking on little brother.
Yeah, probably. Oh, you want to play with your big brother, huh?
Play some Tom Sawyer. Let's.
Yeah. Yeah, it was either. Do you know anything easy? Yeah, let's play YYZ. Oh, fuck you.
Like, you know, when you're writing songs, like you say, you get a riff and you can play around that, but to compose some of those things that are so complex and they got so many different movements, I don't even get where that comes from, man. Because there must be like six different ideas all sort of glued together, or they're just on a different level where they're writing like a classical musician, or yeah.
Because with Neil, I think he was right. Like, he didn't, like, does he ever play the same beat twice in any songs? Like, he's actually composing. He's not just, you know, if like not to jump on AC/DC, but, and he's a very good drummer, but there's like two beats that he plays right through all the songs.
Yeah.
So, but he's never just coming in and okay, I'm just gonna do this, you know, like he's always like writing sections. Like, he must read sheet music, I was thinking, and he's probably
different style, yeah,
you know, writing the stuff out, because it's just so complex.
Well, you get the guys like Johnny Cash and the you know, the Cowboy Chords, right? These guys have probably never taken a music lesson in their life, right? So they've just picked up the guitar, started singing, and that was it. When you get to these jazz players, or you get these people that are, you know, go to MIT and you know, it just blows your mind. I mean, even YouTube now, you'll see a six-year-old, you know, playing something, and you look at it and you just like, you just want to take your guitar and go, okay, that's it. I'm done. This, I can't, you know, compared to, you know, to these guys. But I think writing, I regret in a way not taking music lessons with theory and stuff, because I think that's where that all comes from.
Yeah.
Because especially Rush. I mean, when I listened to Rush, it was like, oh my God, how did they come up with this? Like, this is awesome. And for me to sit down, and you're used to, you know, Cowboy Chords, and that's all you know. So it's whatever you're taught. So if you go to music school, and you get all these different influences, or however they teach it, at least the theory part, and this wheel of fifths and stuff, and it's like things that I'm totally oblivious of. I just kind of play by feel and by ear. So to have that knowledge under your belt to be able to write some of these songs, I'm sure that's where a lot of that comes from.
Yeah, it's mathematical, right? It becomes that sort of really sort of, okay, well, we have to go to this chord really here to make that transition. But yeah. Well, I know, like Phil, I was thinking to you, like you're talking about AC/DC, like Phil Rudd.
Yeah.
I think Phil Rudd's tom-toms, I think, are in the same shape now as when he bought them, because I think he uses them on one tom fill on one song, maybe.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
But he's not there for that, right? He's just there for the backbeat. Just keep the backbeat going. You've got Angus Young. You don't need anyone else messing around in the
backbeat. I don't call them toms. I call them knots, because I not hit them at all. You know?
And just out of curiosity, what accent was that? I'm trying to pin it down.
And whenever I do accents, it always sound like German or Russian. So I don't know. I don't think I shared this with Kevin. I sent this to Todd. There's this guitar player that Vi was talking about, and it's kind of in the news everywhere.
I mean, I recently saw a video of Matteo Mancuso is his name, and I was pretty stunned. I mean, the evolution of the guitar is firmly secure in the hands of people like him and Daniel Guttardo and these kinds of players that it's just new level, you know, the tone, the touch, the notes. They're very clean players, no slop. And there's many others.
You sent the clip to me, and it's weird where he's, when he's picking, it's almost like he's coming at the string at a 45-degree angle or something. which is going to change the attack on the note, right? You would think. So it's super weird the way he plays. I couldn't really wrap my head around it.
I watched that one video and I'm like, oh, holy shit, like this guy's really good.
Yeah.
Then after, because I thought, oh, he's just got this one style that he's doing, right? That's what I thought it was. It's just he's got one style that he's doing and that's it. But then I watched a whole bunch of other clips. And that's just one of many styles that he's invented for the way that he plays.
You find with some of those guys too, though, that like a lot of those guys, you think, okay, well, you can write a great instrumental. Can you write a good song? You know what I mean? They're like, cause that's where I always go back to Satriani and even Vi with that stuff. They wrote really good songs. They had melody. They had a, you know what I mean? With some of those, these super, super technical guys, even like Malmsteen, right? Where you think, well, no one's going to really be humming that. You can't put it on the radio, which maybe isn't a great arbiter of a good song, but
yeah.
They almost play the singer with the guitars because half the time they don't need one. It's just the way that they play.
Yeah. Well, especially with Satriani, like you were saying earlier, like he's writing a vocal melody. It's just on guitar. Have you ever seen Joe play?
Alive, no. My brother has, I haven't.
I cried. I cried. I was not the only one. There was a bunch. So this was at La Ronde in Montreal, and it was kind of like the X in Winnipeg, where you know you pay to get into whatever. It's like $30 to get in for the day, and you get to go watch live music too. And Joe was playing.
Wow.
And this was off of what was it called? Flying
Balloon Dream.
Yeah, is that the one with where he's singing. On like tracks on the album. So he was just, that had just come out and he was playing. Stu Hamm was on bass. Like, come on. Anyway, he's playing. And I wasn't super familiar at that point. Like I did have Surfing with the Alien, but I wasn't like, I didn't have anything beyond that. And there's me and a whole bunch of guys, you know, they've got their vests on with Metallica on the back and Megadeth.
Yeah.
And you've got all these, you know, these bracelets with all the studs on it and like all these big, burly, like biker looking guys. And it's all of us in the audience. And then he broke into Always With You, Always With Me, the song he wrote for his dad.
Yeah.
Thank you.
and he's playing, and it's the solo where he's just a, and I swear to God, like, I just started bawling. It was just so absolutely fucking beautiful. And I look over, and all these big guys, everyone's crying. And all the women are looking at the men going, like, there was like five women in the audience. And they're all like, what is up with these men?
It's a mystery frequency or something that's coming through. Scooby-Doo's going to show up in the mystery van here and try and figure out what the hell's going on.
But that's why and he's like just such a, like, he's not just a shredder at all. At all.
But that even great buys Passion Warfare, like his album. Yeah. Like, you listen to that and it's like, yeah, like I get teary-eyed in some of the songs, and it's like, why? Like, what is it about his music that does that? Like, it just grabs you by the soul.
And that's the part that you can't explain with music, right? And I always go back to, that's why some people like certain bands and you go, really? Those guys? Why? Like, I don't get. But it's that connection, that it's just that intangible thing that there's something there that pulls my heartstrings every single time.
But I think the other thing too is, like, because I have two kids and their musical tastes are like way, way different. Abby's the 103, 106, which is the two super poppy radio stations here, where, you know, it's Ariana Grande and Maroon 5. And Adam Levine used to be an amazing songwriter, an amazing guitar player, a pro rock guy, a pro musician guy, a pro band guy. And then everyone got into his ears. You're beautiful, man. You're beautiful. Like, those other two guys look like Muppets. You know, they didn't care. Yeah. And then it came the Adam Levine show, and he believed his own hype. And it's unfortunate, because he actually is talented, but he decided to, let's play to the algorithm. Like, this is what gets you on radio. You don't actually have to be good.
And that's what's frustrating about, like, for me anyways, like, about people like Beyonce too, where you think, this woman's got one of the great voices, one of the all-time great voices, but I just can't connect with any of that music, because it's just, I just find it boring. Like, it's all synthetic and it sounds like everything else. And it's meant to be that way because it's got to be commercial.
Sure.
I get that. But it's like, you could be doing Aretha, you could be doing jazz, you could be doing blues, you could be doing real soul. You could do anything you want with that voice. And you just, it's like putting, you know, 15-inch platinum rims on a wheelie bin. Just, I don't get the point of it.
That's the proper analogy. That's exactly it. You're putting these great tires on a wheelie bin. Okay, there's your next t-shirt. There's your next t-shirt. You gotta do that. And hey, I know you're doing designs for Corey all the time, but do designs for yourself. You should sell them yourself and put them on your own TeePublic page. Like, honestly. I forgot what I was gonna say. Oh, whatever.
Why did we come here today?
Yeah. Well, we're gonna play this Matteo Mancuso thing here. Yeah,
I gotta tell you too. But while you're sharing that, though, the whole left turn at Albuquerque thing, it makes my heart sing every time here, because that, I remember that as a kid, right? Because first of all, like, being from England, like, Albuquerque is just a stupid name for anything. Like, it's just a weird word. Yeah. And then with that big sort of Brooklyn accent with the bugs, but for some reason a rabbit has a Brooklyn accent. Like, it's just it's so cool. I've always loved it.
Yeah,
Albuquerque.
Yeah, now we just call it doing an Albuquerque, and it's so true. But I mean. I can't remember. You may have replied on this, Kevin. I can't remember, but someone posted something on Twitter talking about, okay, what makes a great podcast? And they were talking about preambles at the beginning of a podcast, right? Where people sell their merch. This is what's going on this week. And then there's a preamble, and then they go into the topic, right?
Yeah.
And then I'm like, oh, shit, we don't do that. We don't do any of that stuff. So I replied on this late. So this one lady, she said, oh, I hate preamble. Like, just get into the topic. I don't really care about what you guys are doing in your day-to-day life or whatever it was. Like, I don't really care. Like, just make a general comment. Not about us, but just in comment. Like, I hate podcasts that don't get to the point. And then I commented, I guess after 7 years, we're going to call it quits, because we've never, ever gotten to the point. I guess it's time to hang up. I guess, you know, we're 7 years in. Obviously, we don't know what we're doing. Maybe we should just quit now. And then one of the, I can't remember who replied, Podcast Overlord or one of those people that promote podcasts all the time. And they're like, this is the absolutely the correct answer. Don't stop what you're doing. Or I can't remember. So they said something like along those lines. But it's true. It's like, if something is scripted to the point that, okay, oh, we're 5 minutes in, but like Todd had a great point, right? And Todd's going off on this point, and he's very electric about it, and he's really pushing the point, and he's, you know, and it's really, really good. But Todd, we're 6 minutes in. At 5 minutes, we're supposed to go on to the next topic, and I just cut Todd off. Is that better podcasting?
Of course it's not. You know, like I said, if the guitarist ripping a solo and he wants to go a few extra bars, like, don't just come back in.
Yes.
You know,
but okay, it won't that's play enough. On the radio because you have 3 minutes. Yeah, that's enough. You get 3 minutes and 28 seconds on the radio. You can't play an extra bar. Let's just take the guitar out. Let's remix this single by Van Halen. We'll just take all the guitar out. We'll just replace it all with keyboards. Yeah, let's do that. Yeah. You know,
but it's the charm of this podcast, me, because it is just like you're literally just, it's just eavesdropping over on two guys chatting in the pub. And this is what normal conversations are. They go everywhere. There's no bloody shape or reason to them. It's just,
I will say, go listen to Rage. They do it better than anybody.
Okay.
They're great guys. Just great guys. Okay. So we're going to play this. We're not going to play all of this, but this really shows us Matteo Mancuso. He's from Italy, I think, is what they said he's from. Does that sound Italian to you guys?
Sounds it, yeah.
But in this clip, he's showing some of the various styles. Like, they're showing some of the various styles he does. So it's not just that weird picking thing he does where he's, like, playing a bass on guitar sort of thing, but there's other things he's doing as well. So he's got a few different techniques that he uses. So let's just, we'll play this and skip ahead if we need to or whatever.
Mark crazy. Knopfler.
Yeah, Knopfler.
Hey, he doesn't use a pick.
Wait till he breaks into country. I got to ask some questions here. So I noticed he's using his thumb and he seems to have a longer nail on his thumb. Is he Todd's the guitar player here, I guess. Like what the fuck is he doing?
On his picking hand?
Yeah.
Well, his picking hand. I mean, he's doing Mark Knopfler solos without a pick. Like this guy's just all over the place. Wow. He's got Holdsworth. He's got, what's that other guy's name? Oh, there's a couple of different influences I can hear.
Demiola, for sure. He's a huge Demiola fan. He does Demiola covers for sure.
Yeah, Eric Johnson in there as well. He's playing that lick with of Dover. Like he played that straight.
That's
on
the
SJ,
one.
Right?
That's the one I was thinking of. Yeah. Yeah. He's got that down pat. My God. Yeah. I mean, and Sean, I had sent you the clip of the Aristocrats.
Yes.
The guy playing. If you want to listen to similar to this, the other guy is just all over the place. Like he just doesn't stop. He just go. It's like, how did your brain?
Aren't you tired?
Like there's no pause button. Like it's like writing a run on sentence without any commas. Like it just goes. Like how do you write something like that?
Yeah.
And then he's got the click track with it. Like he's going with the beat and he's just bang on. Like he's just. Blah, 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 blah.
It's maybe I'll put that on there. Whoops.
Yeah, that's crazy.
It's like it's like someone with
this guy here. Yeah, okay, I'm gonna put this on here so we can take a listen to this and we'll get Kevin's 2 cents on it.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I don't know if it starts off.
This drummer's good.
Yeah.
Bit of Satch Vi type groove.
Yeah.
Yeah. Drummer is, man. This cat's cool.
Was opening up.
You guys got 2 snare drums.
Yeah. One chained and one not, yeah. Super Satriani, hey? Is that one on it?
Oh God, okay, sorry.
Jesus, wow.
And they play with such feeling. It's not just, I'm just going to just shoot a whole, just a machine gun full of notes and we'll call that a song. No, these guys are like, the feeling is it's like you said, like there's no lyrics to it, but it's almost like he's singing with his guitar.
Yeah.
And like you said, when you can swing it like that, when you're playing funk, right? Because you've got that groove to it, this shredding over top of it just takes on a different, completely different life.
That bass player is really good too.
Great bass player. They're tight. They're tight. Well, but it's true though. Auto wah makes everything sound cooler. That's just a fact.
They got concerts on here. I'm going to be watching.
Yeah, you should definitely send that to me, man, for sure.
Yep. Yeah, I'll send it right now. Maybe I'll do the concert here and I'll send that to you.
All right, I'm on, yeah. The aristocrats.
Agree. All right. There it is.
And in the background when you're working.
Yeah.
You kind of lose what you're doing.
You can just like, relax.
An hour's gone by.
Yeah. Or else dump it in here.
Definitely, yeah, man. Cool beans.
Well, that was good.
Yeah, my brother will love that too.
Oh, okay, well,
it's that weird thing though, too, because I prefer typically. I like Stevie Ray Vaughan. I like the guys who play with a ton of feel, who can still play. Like they're still technically brilliant guitarists. But when you get someone like that, who's like you said, he's playing with a ton of feel, but he's playing a million notes as well, and that's such an odd combination to be able to do both in one song. Like, that's crazy.
Oh my God, do we have so much more to talk about? Hang tight. He's going to be back next week, but before you sign out of this episode, I need you to stay here, and I need you to listen to what's playing next. Inadvertently to us, I had no idea. I knew Kevin was a musician. Of course, I knew that. I knew he was talented, but I didn't know he was making his own music, and I received this after the episode was recorded. And I really, really want you guys to hear this. This is one of his songs, Kevin Brown. Boy, I don't know how easy it is to find on streaming, but he's up there. And maybe I'll provide a link here that you can follow. But anyway, this is one of his original songs. I can't remember. This one may or may not have a music video for it, but take a listen. This is fucking awesome. Great guest, and then you realize he's actually a musical genius in the same breath. Like, God damn it. Anyway, Kevin, we love you. Take a listen to this song. Hope you like it. And come back for the next episode with part two with Kevin Brown. And we'll play you another song of his in the next one. Bye.
When you're staring out of your window, tell me what you see. Do you see him driving? Kids are crying for daddy and you wipe their tears away. Do you ask yourself why you're so lonely and why the hell you stay? He's got the morals of a Tomcat woman, so what are you gonna do? He's no good for you. He's no good for you. He's no good for you. Logical liar, you know it, and he'll never change for you. So just remember, you should have seen it coming. There's no one else to blame. Wasting time with a small minor dirtbag is no way to live out your days. You got to find a sense of pride, huh? After all he's put you through. You. He's no good for you. Yeah, you know.
Thank you for listening. And we'll see you next week. And bye. Have a good day.
Fans of the Sean Geek Podcast, this is the Core Geek talking at you. Did you know that the Sean Geek Podcast has merch available? That's right. Head on over to seanmcginnity.ca and click the merch link at the top of the page. You'll be taken to the Sean Geek Podcast store on TeePublic, where you can find the Sean Geek Podcast logo on t-shirts, totes, masks, and more. And best of all, a portion of the sales goes to help support the podcast and allow Sean and Todd to keep bringing great content your way. Once again, go to seanmcginnity.ca and click the merch link at the top of the page. And while you're there, don't forget to download the latest episode.